The laureate Tony Leggett has said about Yakir, his work in the foundations of quantum, foundations of quantum theory, is unique. He is the preeminent person in the world in this very important part of physics. It's not just physics; it's really science. And of course, some of the things that Yakir will cover tonight will blow your minds, so to speak. Certainly blows my mind, because issues such as the non-locality and the different types of non-localities that exist in the universe are very important. Of course, Yakir worked with Dave Bohm, a great physicist, and it was more than 52 years ago, that the Aharonov-Bohm effect was published, and it revealed some deep mysteries of the quantum world. For example, being something there and being here. I won't steal your thunder. You will cover those things. I think he's also going to mention...
See, one of my parts, right?
he and I were talking today, and we got into some discussion about Alice in Wonderland, but he'll tell you a little bit more about it. So, without further ado, I would like to welcome Jeff Tollickson, who is going to come up. Jeff is the head of the Center for Quantum Studies, and he will introduce our speaker.
Thank you. Thank you, Manas. Okay. Well, I'm not going to talk.
Can't hear you.
I'm not going to talk very long. I just was going to show you a couple of videos. One of the main things Yakir is going to talk to you about is quantum theory, which is, for all of you, have you studied your advanced quantum field theory for this talk? No? No? All right. Well, we'll assume that. But it is the most successful theory in the history of human civilization, and it's been real useful. It was relatively cheap to develop, like five faculty member sort of level. But it led to more than half of our whole gross domestic product. So for some of Yakir's studies, as you may know, he recently won the National Medal of Science, and Obama said he was one of the most influential figures in modern physics. And I thought I would just play for you just a few seconds of the ceremony here.
Yakir Aharanov. The 2009 National Medal of Science to Yakir Aharanov, Chapman University, for his contributions to the foundations of quantum physics and for drawing out unexpected implications of that field, ranging from the Aharonov-Bohm effect to the theory of weak measurement.
So actually, the things that were mentioned there, two of Yakir's many discoveries, more than 30 very important discoveries in his career, those two discoveries that the White House acknowledged are some of the things that Yakir will talk about. And I just want to show you two other clips from the Alice in Wonderland, recent one by Johnny Depp, because he was Lewis Carroll was amazingly prophetic in thinking about some of these things, and it's only until very, very recently, last few years, where we thought it could have something to do with reality, and that's part of the work that Yakir has been doing. So let me just show you two quick clips. You'll recognize them for all of you who know the story. You see it? No. It's the drink me potion. You just went down the rabbit hole.
It's only a dream.
Okay. So she shrinks to like nothing. And the other one I want to show you about is the infamous or famous Cheshire Cat effect, which Yakir will talk about also. And you remember that point? The cat that disappears, leaving a lonely...
So I'm going to tell you today some interesting phenomena that was discovered or revealed by modern physics. And by the way, you may have not seen very clearly what the pictures were about. One picture was about Alice drinking that drink, and she slowly becomes extremely small. And I will show to you how that thing that looked like, something only in science fiction, actually that is realized in modern physics. People can do that in modern physics. I will explain to you how. Then there was the other picture where you saw a cat, and the cat disappeared, and the only thing that is left is the smile of the cat. And Alice says in the book, I have seen cats without a grin, but I have never seen, I don't understand what it means to see a grin without a cat. So I will explain to you how quantum mechanics taught me that you can actually separate a grin from a cat. I will not do it with a cat, but I will do it with a quantum particle. What is that? That's the grin of the cat coming in. A quantum particle that has a property like a rotation, which if it's a photon, it's called a polarization, and I will show you how it's possible an experiment that I proposed, that I hope will be done very soon in the laboratory, to take this photon and to send it to one place, and its smile, which in this case is the polarization, goes another place, completely separated from the photon. So it will be shown, I will show to you how to separate the property of a particle from the particle itself. These are two things. One thing will be this property of relativity, the thing that you can change the size of a person, and the other that you can separate the smile from the cat will be a feature of quantum mechanics that I will describe to you. Okay, at the beginning of last century, slightly more than 100 years ago, there were two revolutions in physics that shook the whole scientific world, in fact, the whole world. These were unbelievable discoveries. One of these revolutions was done solely by Einstein. It's called relativity, special and general relativity, and the other revolution that's called quantum mechanics was in fact developed by a number of people. One of them is Einstein, and that will be important later in my discussion. And then there was Bohr and Heisenberg and Schrödinger and initially Planck. So I will try to tell you in this talk some of the fantastic phenomena that has been revealed by these two revolutions. These are properties of nature that are very non-intuitive to us, because we are used to see the things around us. There are things that move slowly, very slow compared to the velocity of light, while relativity discovers properties of things that move very close to the velocity of light. And they are very, very different from our everyday experience, so it's very difficult at first to develop intuition to understand what's going on. And in quantum mechanics discusses properties of extremely small particles, like particles, microscopic particles, like electrons inside atoms, protons, neutrons. Those are such light particles that they behave very differently than the kind of things, objects like chairs and people, etc., that we see in everyday life. So it's also very difficult to understand or to develop intuition about what's happening with these small particles. Now, it turns out, before I start to describe some of these phenomena, that relativity and quantum mechanics enjoyed completely different future. In the case of relativity, although, as I said, it describes extremely non-intuitive phenomena at first, it turns out that after any graduate student, or any student, in fact, that learned relativity and learned to go through the thought experiments that Einstein developed, he can develop intuition that will really allow him to understand what relativity is all about. On the other hand, in the case of quantum mechanics, it has a completely different phase. Even today, If you ask two people that work in quantum mechanics what the theorem means, they will either say, we know how to use it, but we don't understand it, or if they claim they understand it, they will give you two different answers about what the theorem means. So in fact, there is no understanding, no intuitive picture that has developed about the strange phenomena of quantum mechanics, even 100 years after it has developed. Now, in all my research, from the beginning, which is a long time ago, more than 40 years, I believe, 45 years, I was all the time occupied with trying to understand more deeply quantum mechanics. And because I put all my energy in that, I think that I went further away than anyone else in the world to understand quantum mechanics, and I will share with you today some of my understanding. Now, let's start with relativity. What fantastic phenomena was discovered in relativity? And I will describe it just by describing to you thought experiments. The first thought experiment is there are twins, both of them are 30 years old. One of the twins climbed a rocket, and something that is not practical because we don't have enough energy in all Earth to do it, he managed, because it's a thought experiment, he managed to accelerate the rocket to a velocity very close to the velocity of light. And he starts to move the rocket in front of his twin brother, and the first thing that the twin brother sees is something extremely unbelievable. The rocket that now moves close to him very quickly with velocity close to the velocity of light shrinks in its size. It was before a size of 20 meters, and now it's a size of just a few inches. And the twin becomes alarmed. What will happen to his brother there? But of course his brother shrinks the same way, so nothing terrible happened to him. Then the rocket goes away to a star that is 15 years of light years away. That means that light takes light to go to this moon or to come from to this star. To come from this star after 15 years, it takes this twin brother slightly more than 15 years because he moves at slightly less than the velocity of light. He goes to this star and then comes back. So he comes back after 30 years. And when he comes back, he throws the rocket and now things are happy because he comes back to his regular size. Nothing terrible happened to him. He comes out of the rocket and he's the same age that he left, just 30 years old, maybe a few minutes older. But the brother that he left behind is now 60 years old. So relativity shows that the flow of time is not absolute. It depends on how fast you are moving. If you fast, Mary, you move very fast, close to the velocity of light, you can age much, much more slowly than anyone is left behind. So if any one of you is interested in finding out how the world will look 10 years from now, 50 years from now, who will be elected in the next president, after the next president, the only thing he has to do is to find such a rocket, to go in it, and then come back after, as far as he's concerned, after 1 minute, but you will see what happens to the world after 20 years. Now, of course, it could be quite sad for him because most of his friends, if it's maybe not alive anymore, but it can be done in principle. Not in practice, as I said, because there is not enough energy on Earth to accelerate a rocket to a velocity close to the velocity of light. One more important thing that was discovered in relativity is the fact that nothing can move faster than the velocity of light. How can we understand that? Why can't we take a particle, a small particle, put on it enough force that will accelerate more and more and more and more until it gets to the velocity of light and then overpass the velocity of light? The answer is that when you accelerate this particle and you make it velocity closer and closer to the velocity of light, something very strange happens. The mass of the particle, how much it weighs, becomes bigger and bigger, so that when it becomes close to the velocity of light, the mass is so big that no force can accelerate it more and it can never pass the velocity of light. That shows, by the way, another important feature of relativity, and that's the equivalent between mass and energy. As we have seen, that when we accelerate the particle, it becomes more massive. That means that there is some way, some trade-off between mass and energy. And one of the most famous formulas in physics, And probably the formula that every known physicist heard about is this famous formula that E equal to m c squared. Now, c squared is a huge number. That means that if you take just one little gram, a very small amount of mass, and you convert it into energy, you can use the electricity to come out of it it will be enough oil of California for a year. Now, there is a famous cartoon about it that I've seen once in New Yorker, where they show Einstein standing near a blackboard, and then he writes a formula, E equals ma squared. He looks at it, he doesn't like it, so he erases it. Then he writes a formula, E equal to mb squared. He looks at it, doesn't like it, so he erases it. Then he writes E equal mc squared. He looks at it, there is a big smile, that's it. So the idea of the cartoon is that all that involves the discovery of Einstein to find what is the right letter to put here. So the thing that energy, that mass can be converted to energy, is responsible for the fact that we are all alive. Because, you know, the sun has been warming, sending heat to the Earth for 4 billion years, the time that we know that the Earth existed. Now, if the sun was simply burning normal energy, after a relatively short time it would disappear. The only reason why the sun can do it for such a long time is that inside the sun there is all the time a conversion of mass into energy, like there is all the time something like explosions of hydrogen bomb. In hydrogen bomb, you collect together atoms of hydrogen, you convert them to helium. The helium weighs less than the sum of the two atoms of the hydrogen, and that definite loss of energy has been converted to a large amount short loss of mass has been converted to a large amount of energy, and that's why the sun can continue to warm us up and to be responsible for our existence. If not for that phenomena, we wouldn't be alive today. That is more or less all what I wanted to say about relativity, and I wanted again to repeat that if anyone that studies relativity and follow the kind of ideas that Einstein have in order to explain all these strange phenomena, eventually you can develop intuition and you can live happily with relativity with no problem at all. Can I stop here for a minute and see if anyone wants to ask a question about relativity before I come to quantum mechanics in the audience? No one? I explained it so well that everybody understands relativity now. No? No question. Okay, so let's come to the more difficult story and more interesting one, and the one that I was involved with for many years. That is the story of quantum mechanics. Now, let me start by saying, why is quantum mechanics called quantum mechanics? Well, it was discovered at the beginning by Planck that if you take any form of energy, energy can flow by electromagnetic waves, for example, that you see all around you. They are a form of energy and momentum that moves around with the velocity of light. Any kind of wave, water wave, sound wave, any kind of wave is made out of lumps of energy, small lumps of energy that cannot be divided anymore. And those lumps of energy are called quantum. Quantum is a word that says that something cannot be divided further. The quantums of electromagnetic waves, especially kind of electric magnetic wave with light wave, are called photons. So photons are little lumps of energy, very small, that cannot be divided further. So if you look at light, you see that it's completely continuous. But if you take light and shine it through a very little hole, so that very little part of it goes through the hole, and you put a photographic plate behind it, you don't see the photographic plate becoming dark continuously. What you see instead is every time one point appears at one place, one point appears at another place. These points are points where each individual photon hits the photographic plate. And only when you have many, many photons, the thing becomes back like a continuous thing, exactly the same as water wave looks to you continuous, but in fact, if you look with a big enough microscope, you see that the water is made out of atoms. So, or you look at the sand near the sea, and you see that the sand is made out of grains. So these grains of energy, or lumps of energy, were the beginning of quantum mechanics. And they are extremely important to understand what is the most fundamental, strange aspect of quantum mechanics. It's an unbelievable thing that nobody could have guessed it, and even today it's very difficult to accept it. And the idea is the following. If you start with two particles that are exactly the same in the beginning, no difference between them, and they are acted upon with the same forces, so there should not be any difference in their future, and nevertheless there is one. One particle may decide later, deciding quotation marks, may move later to one direction, and the other particles, for no reason at all, move in a different direction. How is it possible? How could nature behave in such unbelievable way? Some capricious way. Really unbelievable. You have two atoms. The atoms are excited, and one of them shine lights after 1 minute, and the other shine lights, you know, when an atom changes their energy, a photon comes out. That's the origin of all light that we see. So one atom will decay, send the light, the pulse of light, after 1 minute, and the other atom exactly the same, for no reason at all, send that pulse of light after an hour. You have a picture about this, don't you? Oh, it's there. Okay. All right, so how on earth can we understand it? So first of all, I want to show you the connection between that and the fact that light is made out of these lumps of energy. Suppose I want to look at the position of a particle. I want to find where it is. And that particle is a very small particle, like an electron. So I put that electron, I know that it is on this surface of the table, say. In fact, it's a surface of glass that you put in a microscope, very, very strong microscope. You look at the particle in the microscope to see where it is. Now, what must you do in order to see it? If it was completely dark, you would not be able to see it. So what do you have to do in order to see it? You have to shine light on it, right? And the light comes and scatters from the particle through the microscope to your eye. Now, if this was a classical light that behaves continuously, I could diminish it, make its intensity so low that it would not disturb the particle at all, and I would still be able to see where it is. But if light is the way that nature reveals about light, that it must be made of this quantum of energy, this lump of energy, at least one of these photons, which is this lump of energy, must hit the electron and come to our eye. Now, although the energy of this photon is very, very small, the mass of the electron is so small that being hit by this photon, it gets a jolt, a real kick. And in fact, you can show that the more, the better you want to find the position of this particle, the penalty that you pay, that you introduce a bigger uncertainty in the velocity. You don't know which direction it's moving after that. So Heisenberg, who was one of the fathers of quantum mechanics, developed a thing that is very famous now, that is called the uncertainty principle. And the uncertainty principle says that the more you know about the position of a particle, the less you can know about its velocity. And the uncertainty principle, I will write a formula, but don't be alarmed, it's a very simple formula. The uncertainty in the position, the uncertainty means how much uncertainty the position means that the uncertainty is this distance, it means that the particle will be somewhere here and we don't know exactly where it is. So this is a number that tells you how uncertain the position. You multiply it by the uncertainty in the velocity, and that must be larger or equal to a universal constant that in the honor of Planck is called Planck constant, and it's a very, very small number. I will not bother you with the exact value of this number, divided by the mass of the particle. Now, it turns out that if the mass of the particle is the mass of an electron, it's about the same value of this number. So the ratio between them is equal to 1. And that means that if you try to localize the electron inside the region of an atom, which is the relevant thing, the uncertainty of velocity becomes huge. So for electron, this uncertainty is very relevant. On the other hand, for us, for the things that we see in everyday life, if you put the mass here to be, say, 1 gram, then the change in the velocity will be so minute that you will have to wait more than the age of the universe before you can see any difference. That means that's the reason why in everyday life we have never suspected that you have this uncertainty, because it has to do, it is relevant only for very, very small particles. Now, that behavior, that strange behavior of nature that says that you can't predict the future, the theory, the nature is non-deterministic. Let me say exactly what it means. In classical physics, if you know everything about a classical particle, you know its position, you know its velocity, then you can predict exactly what will happen to the particle later. No uncertainty at all. That means that classical physics was deterministic. The present determined the future. This is called the deterministic theory. And that looks like a very natural thing. How on earth could it be different? If we know exactly everything about the particle, the future should be completely known. Now comes quantum mechanics and say, no, that's not true. In fact, you can never know enough about the particle to predict its future. It's not only that you don't know, the future is really not known. The only thing you can talk about are probabilities. If you have the particle, you know as much as you can about the particle at one time, you can only predict the probabilities of what will happen to it in the future, and not the future exactly. Now, Einstein was one of the developers of quantum mechanics, was completely unhappy about this situation. And he could not believe till the end of his life that this is the end of the story. He said something must be missing here. And he coined the phrase that says, God does not play dice. You have a picture about that, right? Okay. So what Einstein meant by this, he said, look, I don't believe that it's a fundamental nature, law of nature, that the decision whether the particle will go this way or that way in nature will be just dictated by something like throwing a dice. It could not happen. There must be something missing in quantum mechanics. And he believed at the end of his life that quantum mechanics is not complete. And he wasn't alone. Many people that thought deeply about quantum mechanics felt that something is missing. On the other hand, most people that use quantum mechanics simply learn how to use it to do calculations, and those calculations give a prediction about probabilities, but they are fantastically accurate predictions, and up to now, millions and millions of experiments were done in the quantum domain, and all of them gave exactly the correct answers as quantum mechanics predicted. So quantum mechanics must be true in the sense that it gives the correct predictions, but on the other hand, people don't understand what it all means. So in all my research, I was guided by something that was rephrasing of Einstein's statement. I asked myself, maybe we should think about a new phrase, which is, why does God play dice? Why? Why is nature behaving in this capricious way? Is there something that is gained by it? Because if we find something that was gained by it, then it will not be capricious anymore. It will be something that nature uses the uncertainty in order to get something new out of it. And I'm happy to tell you that the beginning of the answer was already found by me in the beginning of my research work in the 60s, something that I developed with two colleagues, and then lately, in the last few years, I think I've come to the final conclusion that I fully understand why nature plays dice. And using that understanding, I was able to reformulate quantum mechanics in a way that will make it obvious why nature plays dice. And by looking at this new way, I was able to uncover a whole host of new phenomena in quantum mechanics that now is being tested in many laboratories in the world. And I will try to tell you what is this understanding that I have developed. How much more time do I have? 20 minutes? About? Okay, I want to leave a few minutes also for questions, but all right. So, what did I think? I thought the following idea. Maybe nature is trying to tell us that although the two particles start now the same way, and they have a different behavior later, in a new experiment that we do in the future, we find a different behavior, maybe what nature is trying to tell us that there is a difference already between the two particles, but this difference can be found only in the future. This is a very novel idea. There is a difference between them now, but we can't find the difference now. Only later, when we do experiments in the future and find that they are different, their difference will be not only later, but also it goes back and tells us that even before that, there was a difference between them, but this difference can be found only at a later experiment. What does it mean from the point of view of the theory? In quantum mechanics, since we cannot speak about a particle having a definite position and velocity, how do we talk about a quantum particle? We invent a new language. That language was invented by Schrödinger and was shown to be completely correct. And it is a very strange language. In mathematics, we want a language that will be exact. So we want to have a language that if we know what happens at one time, we can calculate mathematically what happens later time. But obviously, this theory cannot tell us where the particle is. It can only be a theory of probabilities. So what Schrödinger discovered was that if we want to describe a particle in quantum mechanics, we have to use something that is called now the Schrödinger wave. It is a function that is different from zero everywhere, just like a wave is everywhere. So we have a single particle. We know everything about it. It is described not by a point, but it's described by a whole function that is different from zero everywhere, like a wave. And the size of this function, in fact, the square of this size, it's the absolute square, but I don't want to trouble you with complex numbers. So it's the square of this size that gives you the probability to find the particle at any place. And that function has a surprising behavior. If you take a particle, a quantum single particle, and you send it through two slits, you have a wall, you have a string here with two slits, you send a quantum particle that has to go to the other side, either through this slit or through that slit. But the particle is now described like a wave. So if it's described like a wave, part of this wave will go through one slit, and part of this wave will go through another slit, and they will behave similar to what happens when you throw two stones in a lake. You throw one stone in a lake, it has a wave emanating from this point everywhere. You throw the stone here, there is another wave, and the place where the two waves meet, there is a phenomenon where one wave at some point that is up cancel the down part of the other wave, and they cancel each other at this point, and that's called interference phenomena. They interfere with each other to cancel each other at some point and increase each other at another point. This electron behaves exactly the same way. If you put a photographic plate here, if you only look at this wave alone, that was closed, a particle could appear sometimes here. You do this experiment by sending one particle after another. Each particle gives you a point here, but you collect many, many such points. So first you do this experiment when you send many electrons one after the other when this slit is closed. So you see that they can arrive everywhere here. You do the experiment when this slit is closed and this slit is open. Again, they can arrive everywhere. But when both slits are open, suddenly a point here remains completely clean of particles. Although from here the particle could arrive here, from here the particle could arrive here, from both places together it doesn't arrive there. So it behaves like a true wave. But then you also say, my God, there is just a single particle going here. If I look through which place, through which hole the particle, to which slit the particle went, I will always find it either here or here. Never in both places at the same time. Because this wave is just a probability. So each time I look, whether it's here or here, it always goes only through one slit. But if I don't look, then suddenly it behaves as if that single particle can go through both slits together. Very, very strange phenomena. That's called the wave-particle paradox. How is it possible that something that each time you look at it, you find it just at one place, but when you don't look at it, it can be in some strange way in both places at the same time. So the thing behaves as a wave and as a particle, but the wave is just wave of probability. Each time you look where it is, you will find it only in one place. But if you don't look, it behaves like a wave. Unbelievable. That's one of the reasons why people don't have intuition about quantum mechanics. So I developed intuition about that already in the early 60s. And that was the origin of now it's called the Aharonov-Bohm effect. What occurred to me was the following. That if we look carefully at the difference between classical and quantum mechanics, and you look at the dynamical aspect of it, dynamic means if you look at dynamics in classical physics, if you have a particle that moves at some straight line, you want to change that. You must put a force where the particle is in order to change the direction where it's moving. So that's dynamical feature. You change the dynamics of the particle by acting with the force. And in classical physics, it's a truism that in order to change the direction of a particle or its velocity, you must put the force at the place where the particle is. No other way. Now, it occurred to me to ask the question, is it true in quantum mechanics? Or is it possible in quantum mechanics when you put a force at one place and the quantum particle moves far away from it, it could still affect its wave in such a way that the probability for the particle to arrive at a later point will depend on forces that were not where the particle is. Now, how could this be relevant to explain the mystery of the two slits? We have the idea from classical physics intuition that if the particle went through this slit, it could not know whether this slit was open or not. Because in classical physics, we know that anything that affects the particle must be at the location where the particle is. Now, suppose in quantum mechanics, it is true, as I discovered, that when the particle moves through here, the question whether this slit is open or not is relevant for it. Because there are non-local aspects of dynamics, quantum mechanics. Again, non-local means that something that I do here affects the velocity of the particle there. This is the new thing about quantum mechanics that was missed before. And after I discovered the feature of quantum mechanics, it began to look that there is hope to understand at least that mystery of quantum mechanics. How is it possible that particles that always is found only near one slit, nevertheless knows whether the other slit is open or not. Okay, so that was one new feature of quantum mechanics that explained at least one part of the puzzle. But the biggest part is why on earth does nature behave in this capricious way? So, as I told you, I asked the question, maybe what nature is trying to tell us that what's relevant for the particle at a given time is not only its past, but also its future. So here's the idea. Suppose the time t1, this is time. At initial time t1, I find the particle in something that is described by a wave psi 1 of x. In time, this wave develops everywhere like all waves do. At time t2, I make another experiment, and I find the particle in different wave. This was psi 1, this is psi 2 of x. Now, Schrödinger equation, the equation how this wave behaves, allow me to propagate this wave not only towards the future, but also back towards the past. This is also about classical physics. If you know, in classical physics, the particle at a given time has a velocity in this direction, you can predict not only where the party is going to be in the future, but you can go back in time and say, where did the party come from if it moved in this velocity? And you can tell also what was the past of this particle. So it's true also in classical physics that if you know the equations of motion, and if you know the state of the particle at a given time, you can propagate it not only to find what will be the future of this particle, but also to find what was the past of it. This is true also in the equations of quantum mechanics. So I told myself, maybe what nature is trying to tell us, that the particle in the time in between this time is described not only by one wave, but is described by two waves. This wave propagating like this, this wave propagating back like this, and it's the meeting of these two waves here, in the middle, that tell us all the story about the particle. This is a very, very strange idea. Why is it strange? It seems that it goes against the idea that we have free will. Why? Suppose I say that I can do here an experiment that will tell me not only what was the wave that's coming from the past, but also what will be the wave that comes back from the future. That the experiment I do here will reveal that the result depends not only on what came from the past, but also that what will come back from the future. What is strange about it? What is strange about it is that I do this experiment, I write the result, say, I know why the particle behaved in this new way, because this new way from the future came back to the present. But then I ask myself, but what will happen if I change my mind? If I change my mind, and later I will decide to make another experiment that will send back a different wave. And then I will not be able to understand what was the result here. Do you understand this? This is a very, very important point. If I have free will, I can change my mind after I saw the result here. I can change my mind, do a different experiment in the future. The different experiment will send a different wave back to the present. And it will give me a different prediction. But that prediction is already written. It cannot be changed. So either nature is telling me that I cannot change my mind, that I don't have free will, or nature is telling me something extremely strange, that when the thing comes back from the future, it erases what I have written, and instead put there another number. That's impossible. Or the third possibility is that this picture cannot be right. Now I claim that this picture is right, I claim that the results are there, I claim that can influence this thing, but nevertheless, I have free will. How on earth could all these things happen together? Okay? A real puzzle. So I will give you now a story that will explain how this can happen. Suppose you have 1,000 envelopes, and each envelope there is just one letter. Somebody prepared these 1,000 envelopes, and in the 1,000 envelope, there is also a secret message. The secret message is written in the envelopes, say, 150, if you choose the correct 50 envelopes out of the 1,000 envelopes, look at the letters that are only in the 50 envelope, you will see the message there. But if you just select at random any 50 envelopes, and you have a huge number of possible selections like this, you will see nothing. You see garbage. Or you will even see wrong messages by luck. But not the chance of seeing the last right message goes to zero with the number of envelopes. Now, suppose in the future you can do another experiment, and the other experiment is the following. You have two boxes, and you can open only one box, but if you open one box, the other box gets burned. In one of the two boxes, you have written the number of the envelopes that are the right ones. In the other box, the numbers are for envelopes that are the wrong one. Suppose you make a choice of the wrong box. This box is now burned. Then forever you will not be able to know what was the message in the envelopes. But if you happen to be to choose the right box, then you go back, open the envelopes, and you find the right message. So here is something that I do in the future, in this experiment, can affect the meaning of the present without changing anything about the present. The number in the present or the letters in the present are all there. Nevertheless, something that I do in the future can either reveal the meaning of those letters or not. And if it does not, then forever you will not know what the secret message is. This is how quantum mechanics works. It works the following way. It turns out that when I do experiments here to check that both waves are there, the experiment also has a lot of noise. That means that it can give me wrong answers. So I have to repeat many, many times the experiment to get out of this noise the correct message, provided I do the right experiment here. If I do the wrong experiment here, send the other waves. Although all the answers will be the same here, they will now be just like noise. Exactly like all these letters in the envelopes. If I don't know the secret key, how to open them, which ones are relevant, it looks to me like complete noise. So, the answer why does God play dice is the following that I came about. A, I need the two particles that behave the same way at the beginning to behave differently at a later time. Otherwise, I couldn't make a choice in the future that will be relevant. In classical physics, if I know exactly the past, I can never have another choice in the future. So to be able for the future to play a role, I must have uncertainty in the state of the particles initially. Otherwise, there is no meaning for the future to play a role. Second, any experiment that I do in the present to find the effect of the future must have also noise in it, uncertainties in it. Because if there were no uncertainties, I wouldn't be able to have free will if the future affect the present. So, my answer, why does God play dice, is the following. God, or nature, wants us to have a new approach to time where not only the past, but also the future is relevant for the present. On the other hand, nature also wants to have for us to have free will. How could the two things live together? Only if there are uncertainties both in the state of the particle and in the state of the measuring device that looks at the particle. Okay, I think this is quite subtle. I am quite proud of myself that I found it, and I will stop here and let you ask questions. Was that? Oh yeah, I forgot about the smile of the cat, yes, okay. So, it turned out that by okay, I have to tell you one more secret about what you have to do in order to see this new phenomena that I discovered. For this, you need to do something that I call weak measurements. In the ordinary measurement in quantum mechanics that you have the disturbance that I talked about, what you do is you make an experiment that interacts very strongly with the particle to find exactly where it is. But suppose instead you develop the notion of a very, very gentle experiment, that you look at the particle so gently that you hardly disturb it at all. You pay the penalty that you get very, very little information. So what you do, you repeat the experiment many, many times, and each time that you get exactly the same conditions, you collect the results, and by collecting enough results, you can find out the message, namely what the particle is trying to tell you. So this is called weak measurement, and that is the way that you can see both waves. Only by weak measurement that sees very little in each case, but when you repeat it many, many times, then you can see what the future wave is telling you. So now I've discovered that if you do such weak measurements, you have many, many interesting new phenomena. Many of them now are being actually experimented in many laboratories in the world. But the one that I'm going to tell you about now, I just nearly finished with my colleagues writing the articles about it, so expect this experiment to be done in the near future. And the experiment is like this. I take a quantum particle, for example, a photon, and the photon has the possibility of moving in some direction, and also the possibility of having a rotation. The little photon can rotate either clockwise or anti-clockwise. And this is called polarization that can have two values. It's value plus one if it rotates one way and value minus one if it rotates another way. So you take this photon and you send it here through half-reflecting mirror that the part of the photon goes this way and part of the photon goes this way. So it behaves at this point like the wave that's separating into two parts. Then you put a mirror here and a mirror here, so the photon now continues this way and that way. And then you put another half-reflected mirror here, and the photon can come this way or that way, and you collect only those photons that came in this way. So that is the initial preparation. That's what I called psi 1, is this one, and the final one is just that one that goes here. So I discard all the possibilities where the photon went this way. And now it turns out that if you do on each one of these photons a very weak experiment, and the weak experiment does the following. If the photon is going this way, you put on it a very, very tiny force, sort of force, that pushes it in this direction. And then you put on the same photon another tiny force that puts it in the orthogonal direction depending on the polarization. If the polarization is positive, it goes one way. If it's negative, it goes another way. Now, the fact that the experiment is very weak means that the change in the photon is very small compared to the uncertainty. So that shift cannot be seen on an individual photon. It can be seen only if you collect many, many photons. And then, if you do the right post-selection and look on only those photons, you find out that the photons that went here were not pushed at all in this direction, as if there was no photon there. But they were pushed in the orthogonal direction as if there was a polarization. And the part of the photon that went here was actually just showing that there was a photon there, but no polarization. So this experiment, I expect, will be done very soon in the future, and then we'll understand what Lewis Carroll meant, that he separated the smile from the cat. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Yakir. Any questions? I'll bring the mic to you if anybody... I should all be perfectly clear, right? There's no...
No question? No one is brave enough to ask a question?
Questions
I don't believe that you accept everything that I say without doubting me at all. Okay, good.
I don't ask about quantum theory, but I'm a communication specialist. I was wondering... As a physicist, theoretical physics.
Yes.
Do you find the language you use limit your effort to describe what you are investigating?
Well, I couldn't hear the details. Can you repeat the question, Jeff?
He says. In the usual way of thinking, the language that's used, the mathematical language, do you find that this limits your way of thinking? Do you find it's
well, it's true. Yeah, it's limited. In fact, what we do when we develop further and further our intuition, together with that, we develop the language. And we use to new words in the language to explain the intuition that we develop, and we have to explain this new word. For example, the word that says, I have a wave describing the particle. Nobody in classical physics will understand what I'm saying. So we develop a new language that will fit what we are trying to say, and it's all the time development. Yes.
It has to be in non-mathematical language, right? It has to be a natural language.
Oh, as far as mathematics goes, we certainly develop new branches of mathematics. In fact, my work has developed a new branch of mathematics that I'm working on now with mathematicians like Daniele, the chancellor here, and some of his friends. And this is called super oscillation mathematics, which shows that you have waves that oscillate slowly, but you add them just in the right way, and suddenly you find in a given region that they oscillate much faster than any of the waves there. So it's a new mathematics that developed in trying to understand what happened in this new physics. And that happened many times in physics, that you find that you need new mathematics in order to describe it, and that new mathematics, mathematicians then check it, and they find that it's there. By the way, it goes both ways. There is also a surprise that many times mathematicians develop mathematics that seem to have nothing to do with physics, and in the future we find that mathematics was relevant for the future physics. So it goes both ways.
Thank you.
Yes, there is some question down. Okay.
I want to go back for a moment to the Einstein equation between matter and energy.
Yeah, for mass and energy.
Yeah.
Yes.
And that once that was established that accounted for this? We said the sun was roughly 4 billion years old, 4.5 billion years old.
Yeah.
When we had that equation and that conception, that accounted for the source of energy that would last for that amount of time. How was it understood before we had that conception? What was the source of energy coming from the sun?
Nobody understood it. In fact, people were worried that they don't understand how is it possible the sun survived so long. People were wondering about it, and they did not have a good answer. They tried to invent all kinds of strange motion of particles, but no explanation was satisfactory. Something was missing. Something was missing, and people did not understand how is it possible that the sun survived for so long. That's a very good question. And only Einstein with his theory came and solved the problem.
Well, because I understand in the 19th century, I mean, Kelvin just had...
Say it again?
Lord Kelvin, the physicist in the 19th century, could not...
Explain.
Or acknowledge that the Earth was around as long as, say, Darwin needed it in terms of evolutionary time, because it would have, expended itself within...
That's true. Yeah, you're completely right.
Okay, it's a question then for the history of science then.
Yes, I mean, it was a pattern that people did not understand fully. They tried to invent all kinds of methods, but none of them really worked fully to explain how the sun was able to survive for so long, giving all the time this huge amount of energy and not disappearing.
Do you think our present account...
What?
Do you think the way we understand it right now?
Oh, there's no problem now. Now they understand fully, then they can calculate, we can live peacefully for many years. By the way, I remember a joke. There was an astronomer that gave a talk to an audience like you, and he said that actually, even with the new source of energy the sun has, in about another 1,000 billion years, maybe we'll begin to have some problems. And an old woman raising her hand said, did you say 1,000 billion or 1,000 million? He said 1,000 million. She said, thank God.
Thank you.
Can you explain the phenomena of quantum entanglement?
The what?
Quantum entanglement.
Quantum entanglement. I can, but it will take entangled time. It will take too long. There is some
just in some layman terms, like simple language.
I can only say about it, something that is related to my own life story, that what you talk about, this entanglement, was discovered in perhaps the most famous article ever written in the history of physics by three people, Einstein, Podolsky and Rosen. And Rosen, that worked with Einstein a number of years, eventually immigrated to Israel, and he was my professor. When I studied quantum mechanics, he was my professor in quantum mechanics. And when the course finished, I was supposed to write, like every other student, a thesis to get a grade for the course. And I selected for the subject of my thesis some problem that had to do with the foundation of quantum mechanics. So it was a problem not to calculate something, but to think more deeply about what quantum means, because from the beginning I was interested in this question. So I came to him, to Rosen, with this idea, and said, no. Listen, young man, you should not waste your life thinking so early about problems that there is no chance to ever solve them. So I suggested to do some practical problems so that eventually we can find some place to work for, because if you will start to work with this problem, I promise you will never find any position to university, you will waste your life. But I told him, Professor Rosen, the only reason why I started to study physics is that because I was interested in this big question. He said, no, look, you are quite talented, I don't want you to waste your time, I don't permit you to do that. So there was a bypass. I did not want to listen to him, he didn't want to give me permission, and very luckily, just at that time, a new professor came to the Technion, that was in Haifa, where I, I did my first degree, by the name of David Bohm, a very famous professor. And the reason why I came to Israel was due to McCarthy. David Bohm was a student of Oppenheimer. He did his PhD with Oppenheimer, and then he went to Princeton. Einstein called him his intellectual heir because he was a genius. He was a real genius. And he was due to get a tenure at Princeton University, but then the McCarthy committee called him to appear in front of them because he was part of Oppenheimer group, and Oppenheimer was known to be sympathetic to communist ideas. So Bohm appeared in front of this committee, and without waiting for his result of that, the board of trustees of Princeton, that was extremely opposite to left, right inclined, they decided immediately to fire him. Did not even wait for the result of the committee. There was even a strike of the students there because they wanted very much for Bohm to stay, but there wasn't, the decision was final. So, actually the committee did not find Bohm communist, and they let him go, but it was too late. He did not get the tenure, so because of that he left Princeton and eventually came to Israel. So the one good thing that happened because of McCarthy was the fact that we met together. And so, that's a story about both, Rosen. So, Rosen was one of the three that invented this very strange phenomenon of two quantum particles that somehow they know each about, they have something like telepathic connection between them that nevertheless does not violate relativity, but it's too charged to try to explain to this audience. If you are interested personally about it, then you can discuss it with Jeff and he will explain to you more in detail, but there is not enough time to discuss this very subtle problem of quantum mechanics.
Thank you. Yes? Thank you. We have one more down here.
Okay. 1 minute.
Is time quantified? Quantum time?
Yeah. Not in that sense that it's quantized in the sense that it comes in lumps of time, no. But nevertheless, many physicists wonder whether when you come to very, very short times, whether it will still behave continuously or it will behave in jumps. And I keep an open mind about it. In fact, it's possible to develop physics to use quantum time that happens discretely, but there is no experimental evidence yet whether it's one way or the other way. So it's still an open question. There are some reasons why maybe quantum time should be quantized, but not, there is no final answer yet. Good question.
Okay. Any other questions? Anybody else?
Well, we still have some cookies and lemonade left, but thank you very much for visiting us. Hope to see you in the future.